Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the Kernel MiniConf. Just before we get started, one point I need to make just after the morning sessions. This MiniConf is being live streamed and recorded. So people who are shouting stuff out from the audience, that doesn't get captured by the mic. I know the tendency here at the Kernel MiniConf traditionally has been to tolerate more comments than most talks at this conference do. Just for the sake of those who are watching the recording or the live stream, and also for those up the back who may not be able to hear, if you want to make a comment, please put your hand up, wait for the speaker to acknowledge you if the speaker feels like acknowledging you, and then wait for our volunteers to come around with a microphone. Otherwise, try and keep your questions to the end. That also works. And you know, if you do shout something out and don't have a microphone for whatever reason, it would be great if speakers could repeat that into the mic so that we can capture that for the recording. Anyway, with that out of the way, status of mainline Linux on Amlogic SoCs with Neil Armstrong. Please welcome Neil.
Hello, thanks for attending. So we'll be speaking about mainline Linux and AMLogic SoCs. Briefly, I work for BeLibre, a French embedded software engineering company, specialized in embedded Linux, custom firmware, SoC support, and product development. So this is part of what we work on. So first of all, I'll speak about the initial state of the art of what was available for these AMLogic SoCs. Now, who is AMLogic? It's a Chinese-American company. We designed some systems and chips for set-top boxes, tablets, TV, projectors. They have at least three well-known SoCs, the S905, and S905X and S912. They designed a new SoC for smart speakers, which is sold by Amazon, for instance. This is a quick view of the SoC family for the last few years. So it's a very small company, so they keep a lot of designs, legacy on the SoC, so most of them are really similar. Only the video part are really different between the different SoCs. So this family is quite simple. The main SoC family is uses 64-bit Cortex A53 ARM core. They have HDMI 2 support. They can decode video up to VP9 10-bit and encode up to 1080p. Gigabit Ethernet and USB 2, maybe next year, and USB 3. They have a lot of base products you can have on Amazon. If you look on Amazon, you search AMLogic or S905, we have 100 different products from China because it's very cheap. The SoC is $7. Is far beyond the other American or big SoC company. They have a few community boards available. So the well-known Odroid C2 here, and the old Odroid C1. Last year, the Chinese company CADAS made the CADAS Vim, which is a really well-designed community board. And in 2017, they appeared three new community boards. So you have the CADAS Vim 2 up there, which uses the S912, which is an octa-core ARM64, the NanoPi K2, which is really similar to Odroid C2, and the Potato, so it's a family of open computer boards. So BeLibre has worked to make sure mainland Linux supports well the Potato board. I will speak about this later. About Linux support. So for the beginning, MLogic always distributed the current source code on their OpenLinux website. So it's classical, heavily changed for the 10, for the 14 kernel for Android. So the code is here, but the code is awful. But they did a 4.9 port last year, which is a little bit less awful. basically, they used the mainline drivers, which they reworked it. So it at least a little bit better, but not really good. And they dropped a big part of the old SoC, so you cannot use them for the whole family, which is the pity of having off-tree support. So upstream support, some independent hackers started a few years ago by pushing some drivers, minimal drivers, and they did boot at least console support for the SN805 and really early ARM64. So community work starts on the website, so linuxmuzan.com, on Freenode, and later on a true Linux mailing list. So what we achieved so far, so up to today for the 4.15. This is a graph showing what the number of commits, file change, and line change. So basically, we started working on 4.7 here. So before was all the independent hackers who tried to do what they could on the weekend and after work. And after, we started working and pushing some huge drivers up to the 4.10 was the biggest, one of the biggest, because I pushed the graphic driver. And 4.12, the HDMI driver. So Baylibre develops and maintains the MLogic kernel upstream, along with Kevin Hillman, which is a long-term Linux developer, and he maintains some TI SoCs. I maintain the DM driver, and I co-maintain the MLogic clock driver, and I maintain the media driver part of it. So the 64 sock upstreaming, so we started in 4.7. We pushed, started with the GXBB with the first 64-bit SoC MLogic made, and we pushed the second generation, so the GXL, GXM, in 4.10. And for the stable 4.14, which is the best support today, you have MMC up to HS200, so we can nearly have the max throughput for the EMMC. We can DVFS, we have a HDMI DRM driver, USB, Ethernet, I2C, SPI, and all the basic peripherals. So you can at least use a complete headless station, and you can start having a desktop station without hardware 3D acceleration. So first, we pushed all the basic support, which is always the same round of drivers you push when you upstream SoC. So the clock, the watchdog, the PWM, the S2C, the infrared, the spy, the classic first upstreaming. Then you have the starting to be complex drivers. So in the ARM64 world, ARM developed an implementation called SCPI, which delegates all the power control to a Cortex-M3 coprocessor with MHU, which is a mailbox interface, and the Cortex cores can communicate with the Cortex-M3 to change the power states. All this was already done very differently and always in a mess by vendors. So ARM did this in a clean way for vendors to implement it. but ARM did the first version of the CPI for the Juno development platform. At the time, all the vendors took the same code and did the same thing, like AMLogic and Rockchip. But in the meantime, ARM decided, oh no, we will change all the protocol, and they pushed a different driver upstream. So I needed to add legacy support to the CPI, which is not really the point to have a standard protocol, if we have a legacy protocol of the standard protocol. So we did it with a long discussion. Like 3 months to have the driver upstreamed, only to add the legacy support, so the legacy protocol of ARM supported, which is kind of... Sorry. I'm gonna switch on that.
Take that one. I'll grab that from you. Thank you.
Okay. And this needed a mailbox driver to communicate with the M3. In the particular ARM world, ARM only gives the IPs with the AMBA bus protocol. And so AMLogic doesn't use AMBA at all. So I need to make a clone of the AMBA driver to support the platform driver. It's ridiculous, but it's needed. After all, we had the final support of the CPI, which is great because you can dynamically change the power without any particular stuff. EMMC support was done. So the first push was only 1-bit, 4-bit with high-speed support, which is the minimal you can have to support SDHC. And this year, for 4.14, we managed to have HS200 and maybe on some boards HS400 with a scattergraph DMA, so you can have max bandwidth support on the EMMC. Like I said, in the end of 2016, AMLogic pushed a variant of the first ARM64 SoC. And with the magic of DevS3, it was really simple to support because you can have a hierarchical DT structure, and it's only a matter to moving common device in a common device tree, and you can have a clean hierarchy for your platform support. The big work was to have a graphical driver, so DRM, which means a direct rendering manager, which is a framework to manage all the graphical stuff and the 3D rendering. So this is underneath the classical DRM structure. So to make it work on any graphical hardware, they separated in 3 stages, all the graphical stage. You have the memory, the CRTC, which is all the rendering of the pixel, and the encoder, which can output the pixel in the good form for the connector. The connector means HDMI connector, DVI connector, VGA connector. So the graphical video processing unit of the AMLogic stack was quite simple, and like every SoC vendor in this world, they did a different thing from other vendors. So you need to map. This is a classical way because it's same from audio, it's same from nearly everything. So you need to adapt. So hopefully the DRM framework is really well made because you have clear structure, and you know the encoder does this. So you only can map to a single part of the VPU. So the first push was to support only CVBS output, so the PAL CCAM output. And after all, they use the Synopsys HDMI controller, like other SoC, so it was simplified because it was only a matter to push support for a custom file, because usually when you take the HDMI controller from Synopsys, you take everything, the controller, the file, and so on. And I think to pay it lower, you can write your own file. So then we need some little trick to support a custom file, but it was done. They also used the internal Ethernet file on the new SoC family, which is fun because they have a MUX, custom MUX for supporting alternatively the external file and the internal file. But it's classic on the Chinese SoCs, in fact. All winner has the same issue. A big push was for, because all the set-top boxes has CEC support. Or CEC is a common protocol, a common single line bus for all the HDMI devices, set-top boxes, TV, and amplifiers. And you can control all the devices on the bus from the TV. And Linux had support, official support for CEC, in 4.10, I think. And the MLogic CEC driver was from one of the first batch of drivers to arrive in 4.14, which is handy if you do a set-top box or you use a player like Kodi, for example. A big subject on all these SoCs is 3D rendering. A big part of the SoCs use Mali from ARM, which is a powerful but quite simple IP. So here is a simple representation of the Mali, and you have a representation of who is responsible in software to drive the Mali. So what you have a GPL driver in the kernel. We talk with the Mali hardware, and ARM gives you a closed source library which targets only a single display interface. So you have a frame buffer Mali, you have a X11 Mali, a Wayland Mali, a GBM Mali, and you cannot mix the four of them on a single system. So at at configuration time, you only have one single display interface available, not like MESA. MESA push support for all interfaces in the same binary. And which is fun is only the vendor can give you the Mali, the libMali, not ARM itself, because they need to tweak the library to work on the platform. So it's kind of fun. We have it working at the for the Mali 450. We have a out-of-tree driver from ARM adapted to work, but we depend on MLogic to deliver the proper libMali. So today we have the frame buffer, we have max performance, we have the X11, and we have Wayland support, non-tested, but we should have Wayland support. A short speak about Lima. Full open source driver was developed to support the Mali hardware, but it stalled in 2 years ago. And this year, an ex MD employee, or ex, I don't know, MD employee, started a new driver, a new clean driver, which has a DM driver and a MESA support. And Mali 450 minimal support arrived like 2 or 3 weeks ago. And I tested on the MLogic, and you can actually render 3D in a full open source way. So it's great. Good news, finally. Now, what is still work in progress? There is still a lot of work on the graphical part. Because I only supported a single plane, only if you have a single desktop. But you can have a cursor plane to accelerate the cursor. You can have overlay planes to show some video on top of the primary plane. You can have scaling of the planes, so you can have a smaller frame buffer or desktop scale to 4K, for example, to have a 4K display. And you have a MIPI DSI output on the new SoCs. This is a simple way of showing what is missing underneath and where it should go in the DRM architecture. So this is why the DRM framework is really well done, because there's a clear path of where everything must be implemented, which is great. So for the DRM planes, today the MLogic SoC supports two frame buffer planes. So frame buffer planes is means you have only a single buffer to show the pixels, but it's also support for multi-scanner planes for video. Usually video, you have one plane for up to three planes. So one for the Y and one for U and for the V. And you can you have specific like NV12, which only has two planes. So this is missing, but it will need to go with the hardware decoding development, which is one of the best features of the MLogic SoCs is hardware decoding, video decoding, which can handle the 4K decoding, which is great on a so cheap device. But today they have a completely custom hardware decoding support in software, even in kernel and software in user space. They have a very bad GStreamer plugin. So we really push to have a correct standard video for Linux memory to memory driver. But I think it's still a very long long way before we have proper support for hardware decoding. And the missing stuff in the display driver, for sure. I missed the audio support. I can't go away. Oh. Sorry. Audio support. They support really basic audio in the 64-bit SoCs. We started developing audio driver as a driver. We have HDMI audio working, for example, but it still miss some SPDIF output and a very specific set-top box scheme, like dual SPDIF and HDMI output. USB support is still ongoing because they use a strange mapping between USB 3, USB 2. And finally, I wanted to talk about the community, which is really important when you do upstreaming. It's not only a question of a company who is working. We still need people to hack the board, and we depend really on the independent hackers to actually help us testing and pushing missing parts. And obviously, we helped because similar associates have the same issues, and we have help from them. For example, USB support was pushed by a German hacker, like the ADC support, for example, which is really some great feature we didn't have time to work on. And for this, Kevin Hillman, which runs the kernel CI, does automated boot testing for that, and we can provide the community with automated testing for other features they push. So this is great. Finally, I will speak about the simple thing about computers. We helped working on the LibreTech CC, the Libre Computer Project, which was based on Kickstarter. For MLogic SoCs, but we will hopefully help do the same for the new WorkChip based and the new AllWinner based boards. To hopefully have a single kernel source for free boards with the same open source support. So this is it. Thanks for attending, and I hope it was clear enough.
Please thank Neil.